Good morning or good afternoon. It's kind of impromptu. I didn't give any notice or anything like that. But I had to get in on something today. I've been watching something occur for the last two or three days. I was in the Red River, Oklahoma, Wichita Falls area. And we were doing a rally for the ranchers that have been deprived of their land by the Bureau of Land Management. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. We'll talk about that in a minute. Donald Trump and a certain judge have got a difference. And Donald, as usual, he's not politically correct. And he said that this guy is Mexican. And what he says about the Mexicans would prejudice this particular judge. And he could not get a fair hearing for the Trump University. We'll talk about that, too. Let me explain something to y'all, for you virgins out there, okay? This judge was a LaRaza lawyer, all right? But for all you folks of the Yankee descent, LaRaza is Spanish for the race, okay? Not a race or one of the races, the race. We dig the corn, they eat the corn, the race. It's a very segregated, very prejudiced thing. This guy has had several controversial decisions. He was appointed by Obama, and he is a regular contributor to Hillary Rodham Clinton. So, there. So anyway, the Donald could have said, I don't think I can get a fair hearing before this particular judge, and had his attorneys request a change of venue, but he didn't. He went the other way. But still, he's holding back. See, Trump does this. He'll let a little bombshell like that out, and he'll let the liberals jump all over it and put their foot in their mouth good and stiff, and then he'll let the rest of it out. The simple fact of the matter is he does need a change of venue. With his political points that he makes on the border, his wall, and all this other stuff, it's just common sense that he does not appear before a judge of Spanish descent. Okay, and I know, he's really an American and everything. All right, good. But he's of Mexican descent, so he's ate a tortilla, okay? And he's been around people like him, okay? He's been around illegals. He is a liberal Democrat, judging a very conservative Republican, okay? This cannot possibly be a fair hearing. And let's talk about the Trump University. I did a study of the Trump University, and I've seen dozens of people who paid and went there. It was a real estate course, but went to this so-called university and came out glowing and saying, I got my money back right away. Everything was great. Okay, back to school, children. I was a real estate agent. All real estate agents that you see come into the game thinking that there's a lot of money to be made. And there is. There is. After you make your bones, after you learn what you're doing, after you work hard 18 hours a day for about 5 years, then there is money to be made. What happens to some people, though, they come in, okay, I'm going to take a course under Donald Trump. Hey, Kylie, up. My granddaughter's up. I cannot use any bad language. Okay? Cannot use any bad language. Anyway, you join a so-called university, and Donald Trump got his name on it. So the novice, that's N-O-V-I-C-E, the novice thinks, oh, I'll go to Donald Trump University, and I'll be a great realtor. I'll make tons of money and all this. And when it doesn't happen, because they're lazy, then it's got to be Trump's fault. Au contraire. It's just like anything else. It's just like Nashville. You land in Nashville with all your music equipment in the back of your pickup, and you just know you're going to write a hit song. So you write a song that goes nowhere. Or the losers pick up and quit. The winners keep trying. In any profession, that's what it takes. All right. Now, I think it was Valerial. Look, I don't know what the name of the university that the Clintons started, but there was dozens upon dozens upon dozens of infractions. Not to mention money that was laundered from the State Department, laundered to Russia, favors doled out. Do I need to say the word email? All these things. But in all of his enterprises, Donald J. Trump started a real estate school. Now, I heard Whoopi Goldberg today saying that he was parading himself as a successful real estate broker and used that to get people to get their Social Security and everything else into the university. That is not the case. Donald Trump is a successful real estate broker. That's why he is a billionaire, okay? he can give you pointers and tips and everything, but he cannot make you a billionaire. He can't do it. You've got to work at it. At any rate, the removal of this judge, or not removal, he didn't ask to remove him. He just, look, I can't get a fair hearing before this guy. Give me a judge that doesn't have any connection with LaRaza, no connection with the Clinton. I don't care who the man votes for. If you got a judge up there that's not LaRaza, he says, well, who are you going to vote for? Well, I'm looking at Hillary Clinton. But he's not giving her money. He's not working for her actively. That's stupid. That the woman that Donald Trump is running against, and this man is contributing to her, that's called a conflict of interest, and it always will be. I'm just a simple old boy from Austin, and I can see that. That's stupid. That's true democracy, though. That's democracy. Yep. Nine wolves and a lamb decide what they're going to have for supper. That's democracy, folks. All right, now let's get on what I did this weekend. I went up to Wichita Falls. I go so many places. And we did a rally for some ranchers up there. The Bureau of Land Management has this little trick where they let come in and claim something, I guess what you call eminent domain. We're here, so it's our land. Now, they're not interested in watching the antelope play. They're interested in that Texas oil that's under the land, which they acquire ownership if they can pull this off. Then, of course, they're going to displace a whole bunch of ranchers. Then, of course, they're going to drain the Red River to frack the oil. And that's what cattle are left. That's going to kill them. That's what they're trying to stop. This type of audacity was what got LaVoie Finicum killed. And that's another reason I was up there. The talk that I gave was concerning a little girl about my granddaughter's age called Teal Finicum, who was one of LaVoie's daughters. And she came on YouTube a few weeks ago rubbing her nose talking about her daddy. And I did a little talk up there called The Little Girl. You can catch it on YouTube on my channel. The Bureau of Land Management has no place in the United States. It doesn't manage anything. It started with the Bureau of Indian Affairs, and it's evolved in the way it is now. And their public relations is like Yellowstone National Park and all this, but that's not the way it is. They have no accountability in any of their balance sheets, none of their books. They don't have to account for anything that comes in or goes out. When they get into a tight spot, they call in the FBI, just like they did with LaVoie Finicum. That's what they did. LaVoie was bringing smoke from them and everything. They made sure he was out on a country road, and they had the FBI shoot him. And that's really what they really did. The man gets out. I've written 3 articles on this. The first article, which went real good, was called No Gun in the Snow. There was no gun in the snow. When Mr. Finicum fell, supposedly he was reaching for his gun, supposedly. The gun didn't fly. All right. Also, he reached for the gun not once, but twice. Well, why would he do that? Did he reach for the gun the first time and change his mind? Or did he reach for the gun the second time and forget to pull it out? And then, because you shoot somebody that got a gun in their hand goes up and the gun flies. That happens everywhere. It always happens. You watch it. Go on YouTube and watch all these cop things. When they shoot somebody who's pulled a gun on them, the gun goes flying off into the sunset. Always. Okay? No gun in the snow. Also, LaVoie Finicum was what they call a wheel gun user. Some people call it a wheel gun. Some call it a revolver. I call it a revolver. Mm-hmm. He's a revolver man. He was an old-time cowboy type, and he used revolvers. I used to use revolvers. You grow. You know, I grew out of it because you can't hit nothing with them. I now use a Smith & Wesson 40 automatic. But I was fond of revolvers at once, and some of the old Western-type guys, they depend on revolvers more. But you got a splatter there that I don't like. If you're a gun nuts, you know that. There's a space between the cylinder and the barrel. Lead shavings and hot gas go on both sides, and it will actually tear up a piece of paper. Anyway, that's why I know that LaVoie was set up. The other reason I know he was set up, he was pulled over for 4 minutes. sitting there while the lights flash. Finally, he yells out the window, "We're going to the sheriff," and he drives down the road about 4 miles, and they're waiting for him with a roadblock, with snipers in place. Okay? They didn't try to tase him. They didn't throw... I said in one of my articles, you know, the guy came up behind him and shot him in the back. My granddaughter, Puck, could have got him with a rock. Kylie, here, could have got him with a stick. There's no reason. There was no reason for that kind of nonsense with a 60-some-odd-year-old man or 50, whatever, waving his hands in there. I mean, these big old FBI jocks would run up behind him and tackle him. You know, run up behind him and tackle him. What I'm amazed is that when Michael Brown got killed and everything, all the black Americans ran around with their hands up. That was the sign of Michael Brown. Well, LaVoy had his hands up, too. You know that? He had his hands up, too. So where's our sign? You know? Where's our sign? Okay. Now, monkey business again. The couple whose child jumped into the tank with the monkey, the police in Cincinnati declined to file charges today, which is common sense. The liberals have jumped on it, and they wanted to bring attention to the fact that the father had a criminal record. Now, the man's been straight for like 4 or 5 years. He was working the day his son fell into the tank, right? Another thing, and I know I got a good friend, Casey Nunez, who's an animal rights advocate. He's a good friend of mine, but I was thinking if I were at the Cincinnati Zoo and my grandson, little Will, had fallen in that tank, I would have shot that monkey right away. In fact, I probably would have shot all the other monkeys in there and told everybody, okay, now you got 10 dead monkeys. Work that out for you, okay? Because it was a dangerous situation. The ape in question, while he didn't appear to be doing anything wrong, he was behaving with the child as if it were a little monkey. It's just a matter of time before he snatched his arm out of socket, crushed his head, or some other nonsense. You know, it was just crazy. But anyway, let's see what else has happened. What else has Donald said that's stupid? He's got most of the Democrats and liberals running scared. Whoopi, I watched Whoopi Goldberg on The View for comic relief, and she's always been on racism because he said black American. Look at my African American friend. Now again, I'm a redneck. Okay. I'm a redneck, but I would have said, look at my friend over there, and let the audience judge what color he was. But he said African-American. She made a big deal out of that. Racism this and racism that and racism over here and all that kind of, okay. But you know, Whoopi Goldberg is the most racist person on the planet. Everything she says has something to do with her complexion. Everything. She gets up in the morning, and she looks in the mirror, and she says, how black can I be today? Because she's made a whole career on being black. That's what she's done. A whole entire career on being black. I need the money. Okay, I need the money. I wish I could make a career on being white. Just get up in the morning and start bitching about being white. You know, and not having no money because I'm white. Couldn't get a job because I'm white. If I could do that, my life would be perfect. I'd be the greatest pale face you've ever seen in your world. And the immigration thing, they jump on the immigration thing. I'm going to say it again. I've said it before. I'm going to say it again. If you don't have feathers in your hair, you are the product of an immigrant. Okay? It's as simple as that. If you're not an Indian, you're an immigrant. And even the Indians were immigrants. We just don't know which coast they came from. There's evidence they might have actually came over from the East Coast, which I doubtful because they're Asian DNA. It probably came through the Bering Strait theory when the water was low. That's probably what it came from. Of course, the Mormons, they think they came from the Middle East and they landed somewhere in South America. They moved that around and all that. But they're the only ones that were here when we got here. So we're all immigrants. The trick that Donald is trying to pull, or not the trick, the idea, is there are rules. There are rules in order to get in the country. Okay? A little history lesson. We're going to go to the History Channel now. A little history lesson. This trick of open immigration and porous borders has already been attempted. It was attempted about 2,000 years ago by the Roman Empire. As they gradually lost control of the empire, they came up with this grand scheme. What we'll do is we'll let people come in, and we'll grant them Roman citizenship. And they'll be so happy to be Romans, we won't have any more trouble. Mr. Goths, Huns, whatever ragtag muffin came over the next mountain, didn't give a damn about the Roman Empire. They wanted wine, women, and gold. That's it. And they didn't have any allegiance. You know, huge Roman legions at that time couldn't even fight because they were mostly mercenaries. They were mostly mercenaries, as opposed to the Roman farmers of 400 years previous who were fighting for their farmland, and people like Caesar were leading them. Okay, that's the kind of thing. Now, when you have Mexicans or Americans of Mexican descent who have been here in this country for 300 years, they are Americans. When you have Pablo, who jumped over the border and applies for welfare, won't pick an orange, that's not an immigrant. That's a burglar. That's a vagrant. And they want to chow down on everything you've got and give nothing back. And the Italian immigrants, you know, you've all seen the movie, Godfather, all of them, they come over to this country because they wanted a better life. And if they got in the mafia, they made a better mafia. What they didn't do, while they appreciated their food and their country or their culture and all that, that's all very fine. But you watch on Mulberry Street in those days, and I think even today, when they have like Columbus Day, and they have all the vendors out in the street, and they're blowing the tubas, and they have the little statue of the Virgin Mary coming down, and everybody's putting dollars on it and everything. Look at the flags. They're not Italian flags. They're American flags. Because these people were intensely proud of being an American. The same as the Chinese. They came all at 5,000, 7,000 miles over the Pacific Ocean. They worked their butts off when they got here. But the main trick was to be in America. Because some warlord couldn't come over the next hill, rape your wife and little girl, take all your gold, knock you in the head. It was reasonably safe in America, and you could work. You could get work. That is why Donald Trump's theory, and he always, it amazes me. I am so amazed. He has to re-explain every time. I'm not talking about good people. I'm talking about criminals. I'm talking about criminals who come here, will not contribute to the society, and want to take, hi, Crystal, want to take everything. That is a criminal. Hey, baby, you should have been with me this weekend. I had some good music. Anyway, they're criminals. They come over here to steal. That's all they do. And they come over here waving the Mexican flag. Okay, if you want to wave the Mexican flag, go back to Mexico and wave it there. And that, who was that? Vicente Fox, okay? If Donald Trump is elected president, Mexico's going to go to war, war with the United States. Hey, man, you were the president of Mexico. Little note here. Get your pen out. People are trying to break out of your country. You know, they're trying to get out of your country. They want to come here to get away from your country. You ran it so good, they're willing to leave their whole family just to get here and live in the Mojave Desert south of Los Angeles and hope to God they can steal a hubcap because it's better than what you had going. Okay? It's as simple as that. Your country is shit. I hate to say it, but it is. Okay? Spicy shit, but it's shit. But that's a pretty big rundown on what's going on this week. I'm going to make a prediction. Donald Trump is going to be the 45th president of the United States. Like it, lump it, or leave it. There's a thing called a political pendulum. I've written about it many times. The political pendulum goes left and right. Left and right, okay? It never sticks in the center. Okay, we've had 8 years of Barack Obama. Now, good, bad, or indifference, I'm not going to get into his policies. Man's a liberal Democrat. 8 years of this, okay? What Donald Trump is the return part. And you're going to have 8 years at least of that insanity. Okay, which everything that was sociologically trying to improve things, probably going to get mostly undone, go back this way, go back that way. That's the way the political process works. Okay, you're never going to change that. They always talk about the founding fathers this and the founding fathers that. The founding fathers did not get along. George Washington did not agree with Thomas Jefferson a lot of the time. I don't think Ben Franklin agreed with anything. Read what he said. Read what he wrote. Most of the time, it's a challenge to people. It's a challenge to tell them, if you do this or if you do that, this is going to happen to you. This is going to go on. Political people don't always get along. Lincoln didn't get along with anybody either. He was simply the best choice of the newly founded Republican Party. And when he took over, he suspended habeas corpus. He got involved in the worst war in our history, actually. The worst war in our history. He could have handled it a whole bunch of different ways. He did not start the war to free the slaves. There was a thing. Let me explain economics to y'all, okay? The South had cotton. The North had Wall Street. The North had shipping, ways to get the cotton over to England and Europe, places like that. The South was paying an enormous amount of money for this privilege. Hey, Nicole! paying an enormous amount of money for this privilege. Now, the way they grew the cotton, and it was a bad thing, okay. They had slaves to grow the cotton. So the North said, well, let's see, we want the cotton and we want all your money, but we don't want you to keep the system you got going to keep us pumping the cotton up here. So they started this movement. There were several reasons that the states in the South pulled away from the North. Number one, they legally thought they really could. They did not think that this thing, this United States thing, was that binding. You could be united if you wanted to. You didn't have to. Also, what we've got now that you call the United States is a federalistic constitution. It's no longer 50 different regions or small nations united in a common cause. It is a huge conglomerate based in Washington, D.C. that dictates terms to its servants. In other words, ask yourself this. Why does your state government even meet to pass laws? Why? Take California. What if California had a vote? We're going to have a vote, okay? And we're going to put this on the ballot. We're going to outlaw gay marriage. We're going to outlaw gay marriage. We're going to have it again. We're going to get out there. We're going to pass a law. So they get there and 61% of voters turn out and they pass a law against gay marriage. You know what's going to happen? Obama's just going to come in and say, no, it ain't going to work. It ain't going to work. Well, as a matter of fact, you think I'm being facetious? Okay. In California, you can buy marijuana for medicinal purposes. I think in Oregon, in Colorado, you can just buy it for the hell of it. Those are state laws decided by the people of that region. But it's federally illegal. Federally illegal. So the government can come in any time and just stomp California's butt, Colorado's butt. No, you can't do this. We saw you, we're live, and wanted to say hey. We'll chat later. Yes, ma'am. Hey, would you still go to dinner with me in San Antonio? Because I really would like, wait a minute, you got a big old boyfriend. We better talk about this. Anyway, they'll just come in there and stomp your butt. Yeah, it doesn't matter what laws you pass or anything. That is why the Texas nationalists, good girl, I look forward to it. The Texas Nationalists, we have several layers of secession here. Of course, there's the radicals that want to just declare war on the United States and go at it. And then there's the ones that want to just succeed and hope they don't jump on us. And then there's a bunch that go through the Treaty of Arkansas and things like that and say, well, if we adhere to the Treaty of Arkansas, we can sue in court and get permission to do whatever we want within our borders without being interfered with, and they have to suck it up. It's kind of like having a divorce and the ex-wife can live with you and you don't have to pay no rent. Like that. And that's more or less what I'm after is I want state sovereignty. I want places like California to be able to pass marijuana laws, and when they pass it, it's their business. You know, if it goes sour and screws up, Then the government say, well, you did it. You're the one that wanted it. Well, you got it. But it's their business. I don't know a damn thing about California except the girls are pretty. That's it. If they pass a marijuana law, it must be for their own good because majority of the people said, let's do it. If we want to secede in Texas or we want to redefine the southern border, well, California, actually, they do know about that because they're in the same exact position we are as far as oceans and borders. Now, Nebraska doesn't know anything about that. I don't know anything about corn or wheat. So if they start passing laws about corn and wheat up in Nebraska, we don't have a right to come in and tell them, oh, that, you can't pass that law about corn and wheat. Because we got some corn out here, it don't amount to much, but we got some. We make whiskey out of ours. But this is what's happened with your federal government. And this is what Donald Trump is trying to change. And of course, last but not least, got to take all them nasty old guns away from people. We can't have people going in restaurants and shooting people up and maybe getting shot back at. Can't have that. Mm-mm. Cannot have that. We got to make sure that the population is completely disarmed. Okay? I want you guys to Google something. My friend Crystal Lee Laramoa that I was with this weekend is in a movie called Amerageddon. Amerigeddon. It was filmed right down here in Brazoria County. About what can happen when the government goes out of control and how Texas might succeed. I think you will enjoy it if it comes to your area. It was directed and starred in by Mike Norris, who is Chuck Norris's son, friend of ours. And it's got a lot of action in it, and Crystal plays a real cute part. And I think you're going to enjoy it. We talked about it a lot when I was up there at Wichita Falls. Other than that, glad y'all chopped in. Hope everything works out. God bless America. And Kylie was especially happy to see you here tonight. Everything. You finally got to see Grandpa do something besides drink martinis on your porch. Everything. Y'all be good. I'm going to push this red button right here, and I'm going to go ahead and publish this mess. Ciao.